Hi everyone, this is Qais Radaideh from Midwest Cardiovascular Research Foundation. We have a review article, Iliac Vein Epidemiology, Diagnosis and Treatment of Iliac Vein Compression, that was accepted at Vascular Health and Risk Management, and here we're discussing the important point of this review article. Iliac vein compression is a clinical syndrome of unilateral leg swelling and pain caused by compression of the common iliac vein by an overlying common iliac artery, usually happens on the left side. Symptoms again can vary from varicose veins, hyperpigmentation, unilateral leg pain, swelling. The true prevalence of this disease is not really known. It's reported to be 2 to 3 times more common on the left side. Quality of life, no surprises, further reduced on those patients, especially in the presence of DVT. Different imaging modalities are available to diagnose this condition. Usually history and physical exam identify symptomatic patients. Non-invasive tests include Doppler ultrasound, CAT scan with venous filling, MRI. Further invasive tests like venography and IVUS are further discussed in this paper. Of note, intravascular ultrasound is the gold standard to diagnose iliac vein compression. It allows for minimal luminal area measurement. It allows for reference area measurement. This would allow for proper sizing of the stent. It also allows to visualize areas of fibrosis and spurs inside the vessel. Further studies on cost effectiveness and comparison between these different modalities would need to further evaluate the efficacy and the cost effectiveness of IVUS. Now, different therapeutic options are available for iliac vein compression and have evolved in the last decade. Of note, angioplasty alone, especially in the presence of spurs and fibrosis, is not effective. Until last month, there was no dedicated venous stent in the US for the venous territory, and wall stent was an off-label use here in the US. It's important also to distinguish when stenting of iliac vein compression is to be done. The presence of thrombus or the absence of thrombus is a key point, especially the acuity of thrombus need to be taken into account as different therapeutic options are available. Now, going back to the stents, with the wall stent, there were limitations of foreshortening, possibility of higher rates of recoil, and possibility of jailing the contralateral iliac vein. In order to overcome those limitations, nitinol stents have been developed with different trials. We do present a table in this article comparing those relative radial forces, as those nitinol stents have showed good outward compression radial force, crush resistance, and the flexibility to take the shape of the vein. The presence of DVT in the iliofemoral region would predict post-thrombotic syndrome. Different studies have evaluated the role of catheter-directed therapy. Of note, the ATTRACT trial, and despite the negative result, catheter-directed therapy should remain an option for those patients, as the open vein hypothesis was not properly tested in those patients. If the occlusion was chronic, in a study of post-thrombotic syndrome with chronic occlusion, the AXIS PTS have shown excellent results when ultrasound-directed thrombolysis was used prior to stenting. In conclusion, diagnosing iliac vein compression is important as there are different therapeutic modalities with effective approaches and good results in reducing the improving the quality of life. Different imaging modalities exist. IVUS is the gold standard. The vernacular, the Vertus trial, which are behind the recently developed nitinol stents, are showing promising data of the new stents. It's important to note that there are no consensus on antiplatelet regimen post-stenting, and whether antiplatelet on top of anticoagulation would have additional benefit is not truly known. Finally, I'd like to thank the authors who contributed to this article. Thank you.